not about our personal past and back. God, whether we're on this platform, or whether we're sitting, or we're in the back working hard with kids, thank you, Lord. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. But God, I pray we realize that this morning. But Lord, we don't just pass it off. But God, this is a real time and a real moment in life. So God, I pray that you find us faithful right now, God. As we share your love, as we interact one to another under the love of God, under the power of God, under serving him. Lord Jesus, you did it all for us. Find us faithful. Thank you right now. In your name we pray. Amen.
you just sung. So, because of the previous statement, let our faith be more than anthems. Let's sing.
So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. In our weakness and temptations,
that my hands are not busy doing whatever else takes me away from my worship of God. My hands are in plain view because I want every part of me, even my hands, which tend to be busy, which tend to distract me from you, Lord, from that worship. My hands are in plain sight. I surrender and my hands, my talents, my ability, all that I have and all that I am, it's yours. That is the picture of raised hands. A bowed heart and raised hands. God, you do not want raised hearts and bowed hands. That's the way we do it going forward sometimes. And God, I want to bow my heart right here and just tell you that it's Christ alone. I believe. I believe that you did what you said you did. Because there's no one on the planet, nothing on the planet that could have changed my life. And you did. You did. That's why I believe. So we honor you this morning with changed hearts, changed lives, God. We honor you in worship this morning. In Jesus' name, you can be saved.
You know, when you think about this short book, Philemon, it's real and says so much to us from the standpoint of who we are. Onesimus, runaway slave. Philemon, a wealthy Asiatic Gentile. Paul, former persecution of Christians, are your characters. But the reality is that many folks today are runaway slaves. Jesus Christ has died for every one of us. And some of us are disobedient and runaway slaves. But the thing is, he cares. He loves. He doesn't want to abuse us. When we think of slavery, you try to imagine being a slave this morning. Some of our guys, ladies, have been in prison. Somebody tells you what time to get up, what time to get dressed, what you can eat, what you can eat, what you can say. Those kinds of things. That's probably the closest extent we've got to slavery. Some of us, you can picture, you see the movies, you see the shows of the abuse. Slavery. Think about it. Now switch gears. Put your mind in the place of a slave for a moment. What it must be like. Think about that this morning. When we think about the standpoint of real life, real decisions, real outcomes. As we share these first few verses in a moment, society of that day accepted slavery. Doesn't mean God did. And what Paul was doing was seeking forgiveness for Onesimus, the runaway slave, from Philemon. And he desired Philemon to accept Onesimus back as a Christian brother. Could I tell you this morning that the Lord Jesus stands at the right hand of the Father pleading for men and women and boys and girls to come back to the Father? That's his desire this morning, is that we run to the Father. Don't run to everything else in the world, but run to the Father. And when you look at Philemon, the primary aspects there of the Christian life, and we're going to talk about this morning, is faith and love. Probably don't get tired of hearing about love, but it's something that's significant to the Christian faith. Unity this morning in Bible study, dealing with love and unity and the fact of one accord and Pentecost and all of that kind of stuff. Great Bible study this morning. Just calling us to be unified, to do what God's called us to do and to be what God's called us to be. And here you have Paul that's writing as a prisoner himself. Prison in Rome. And thinking about this young man, one that he had seen his life change. And he was pleading to believe. Let's look at it, these first seven verses. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, being out here this morning, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, and dear friend and fellow worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archibus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Talking about house churches and planning churches, great evidence for that right there. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Look what he says. This is a prayer that, a desire that you and I should have. Paul says, I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your faith. Think about that significance right there. I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. Verse 6, I pray that you may be active. We talked about telling your story. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. There's nothing like sharing your faith and seeing somebody come to Jesus. Verse 7, your love has given me great joy and encouragement because you, my brother, have refreshed the hearts of the saints. Before we pray this morning, I want to just ask you, are you a refresher? Are you that fresh aroma when you come into the circle of conversation? That's the desire that he has for us, because we're in real life, we make real decisions, and because we're in real life, we make real decisions and there's real outcomes. But sometimes we don't think about the outcome. We'll play for a few moments, and then we're out of the conversation. But the reality is, life goes on. And then we refresh that individual that we've made in contact with. Would you pray with me? God, this morning I pray that as we think about real life, real decisions, real outcomes, God, that we desire to be refreshers. And so, Lord, this morning, speaking to our life, we think about what it must be like for Paul to be speaking into the life of Philemon, for this young runaway slave, Onesimus, God. And Lord Jesus, I thank you that you're speaking into our life. We're runaways. And Lord, many of us without direction because we've never given our life to you. And Lord, that some today they've given your life, their life to you, that they're running away, they're not walking in obedience. God, help us today. God, teach us about that greater today than ever before. Because, God, we're in the midst of real life, real decisions. Because of those life and those decisions, those life decisions, then the outcomes are detrimental to our life and to others. So, God, help us as a church to see that this morning. Open our eyes to the cornerstone of our faith, the Lord Jesus Christ, and his desires for each of our lives. Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I'm telling you, when you think about the fact of being a slave owner, think about even being a slave, what life must have been like. The closest depiction you and I get is from the avenues of movie and TV and all of that kind of stuff. And just the things that happened and how lives were stolen and all of that. People mistreated. God never, and even today, we live in the most active slave trade that's ever been. Matter of fact, we don't even think about this, but when you think about sex trade, Mississippi is in the top three of trade in the slave trade and that kind of thing. We don't tend to think about that, but I'm telling you, we live in real life, real decisions with real outcomes. And so when you think about Paul's request to Philemon, a wealthy Asiatic Gentile, when you think about this request, we would think, well, that's just an impossible request. I mean, when he goes back, what's he going to do? Kill him? Resell him? What, punish him? What's he going to do? I mean, it was an impossible request. But Paul knew the will of God. And Paul was bold enough. We talked about that boldness this morning in Bible study. The fact of the Holy Spirit of God working in our life. And through the working of the Holy Spirit of God, then you gain a boldness to be actively involved, not in an arrogant kind of boldness. God never calls us to be arrogant. God calls us to be bold, to proclaim the word. That's what Paul did to Philemon, for Onesimus. He was really speaking for this young man who was in trouble, but yet had got his life changed. I'm telling you, sometimes you and I just need to stand in the gap. Real life, real decisions, real outcomes. And we need to stand in the gap. Be bold enough to stand in the gap for somebody who needs that touch of God. But let me just ask you this morning, is there something that you need to make what some would consider an impossible request this morning? Maybe there's been some strains in a relationship. Maybe some things with God. You know, last week we talked about that authentic love. And we talked about God's love for us. And the fact that he loved us so much that he sent Jesus his son, that he came and he died for us, that he gave his life for us. That's how much he loved us. How much he loved you. We talked about the fact of our love for others. The greatest, second greatest commandment is the fact that you love your neighbor as yourself. But then I closed out just talking about that family love, that spousal love, that inner personal, that intimate love. And ladies and gentlemen, this morning, when we think about this authentic love, when we think about real life, real decisions, real outcomes, you know, we've been challenging our men because we don't like to use this word intimate, because we automatically go to the physical, sexual aspect of it. But God desires for us to be intimate with him and intimate with people. And guys need to learn to be intimate with each other and the fact of a healthy relationship and just sharing your life. Sharing your thought processes, holding each other accountable. That's the reality of the moment. And I'm telling you, you know, when you think about this question that may be an impossible request, you know, is someone asking you for something that you find difficult to give? Is someone needing something from you that you find difficult to give? Again, this morning, talked about the church there. You ought to go back, if you went to Bible study, go back to Acts chapter 4. Look at what was taking place after Pentecost. And look at the fact of the New Testament church. Because here's the deal. That's the picture of who you and I ought to be today. We ought to, listen, let me just go ahead and tell you. We ought to not even have the welfare system that we have today, because it was the church's responsibility and Christians' faith. Never was designed for what it was for. The Word of God was put out there, and the church was to take care of its own, plus the communities to which it lived and ministered. Gene and I will be in Africa in 2 weeks. And what we see over there is the communal aspect of that, and others helping others all around. They'll give you what they got. That was the picture of what's pictured in the church. When you go look at Acts chapter 4, we may not like it, but what it said was, the fact that you saw somebody else in need, it wasn't your greed, you gave it away to meet the other person's need. And you brought it together. People sold their land, sold their houses, sold whatever they had to put it in a pool together so that everybody would gain from it. Well, that's a picture that we don't like to talk about. We build on the wealth of what we've got. We want to see how big a mountain we can build. And guess what's going to happen to it? It's going to burn up. Or somebody's going to fight it. That kind of stuff. That's what's going to happen. And we don't even realize what we've got till you give it away. Try giving something away this week. The little passing on thing that our ladies did and some of our guys. And I was talking to somebody the other day, and they got ready to case him up at the snowball stand. Somebody came up and ordered some snowballs. The person before him had paid for them. Didn't know who was coming. Case said, "You don't owe anything." He said he had the weirdest look on his face. "What do you mean I don't know anything?" He said, "Somebody else paid for it." He said, "Well, that's just awesome." So he handed her some money, and he told her, he said, "Pay for the next person." Pass it on. Can we learn that? Can we learn when you're at Walmart or you're in the drive-thru and you're waiting to pay, they'll already have an order of a person behind you. Just get the total and pay for it. Watch what happens. Just do something for somebody and don't expect anything else in return. Real life, real decisions, real outcomes. I mean, it's real time in today's world. Impossible requests. You got somebody you need to forgive? And everything inside of you wants you to go to them? And you're holding back? I mean, just real time decisions. I mean, just need a fresh encounter this morning with God and need somebody just to come and refresh you this morning on that unity. That's one of my favorite passages. I was in our class this morning. I was teaching this there in the Pentecostal moment in the act of Pentecost of what God really did. And I prayed we'll see Pentecost. I was talking, in fact, listen, you've heard me pray this pulpit. One day I pray that God shake this building with the power of God. Someone says, "Brother, you really want that to happen? That would scare me." I said, "Well, it's going to scare me too, but that's a good thing." Amen. It's a shaking of the power of God that we really feel, that know the power of God. That people drive down the highway and the building shining, not because of me and you, because of the power of God shining, the shining glory of God. Real life, real decisions, real outcomes, life change. That's what God wants to do. The power of God like you and I have never seen. Here's the deal. We just don't want to be bold enough to pray for it. We've got to pray for it. We've got to seek it out. Seek the power of God like we've never seen before. Because when you look at that picture of the church in Jerusalem, that picture there is a picture of the church united by prayer, practice, witness, and sacrifice. When you go back to Acts and you look at that, I mean, that church was together. It was jail. And that's what God calls us to be. God doesn't call us to be believer against believer. Man against man, woman against man, woman against woman. God doesn't call us to do that. He calls us to be unified. And when you look at that picture of the church in Acts, you see that church in prayer and practice and witness and sacrifice, doing what God really wants them to do. I mean, it can be a reality. That's what God's asking of us this morning, that you and I would just really seek the power of God. Biblical reading, sharing the Word of God. I'm telling you three keys that's really simple this morning, very basic, very looking back, even over the last weeks, God just began speaking my life. See, here's the deal, and sometimes you forget, God's already speaking this to me so I can share it with you. I'm not preaching to you, I'm just sharing alongside of you. I'm right here with you. I'm not up here on some elevated platform for that. I'm walking beside you. And the thing is, God's got great things in store if you and I will just get on with it. And you know, that biblical reading and how it applies to you and how it applies to me and how it applies to us is all key. So what should we do when we read this Philemon, when we look at all this, and how does it apply with us? Even looking back over the last week, you know, we talked about the fact it's okay not to be okay. Just admit it and understand, listen, we're just messed up people. Remember, we're dumb sheep. We stink. We stink. We're not what God initially created us to be. There was a time of falling and a time of separation. But all God still wants us to do. Remember the road? I don't have that Bible with me. It's on my other Bible. Hold the road. God's got so much to do. Let me just give you these things real quick this morning. When we think about heart like his, when we think about the fact that God created a clean heart for me, God loving others, God, you teach us how to love others like Jesus loves us. God, really embed that in our lifestyle. Because I think, and as God just began to show me that, even from the close of last year, moving into this year, 2015, God just began to show me we're not where we need to be. And loving others like Jesus loves us. So, you know, when you think about it, what Paul says this morning, And he's coming down. By the way, when you look at Philemon and you look at the dear friend and fellow workers and all this, these were sisters. These were folks that were working in the church and everything that was happening within the ministry of the church. And then that encounter with God, that grace and peace to you from God, the encounter. Listen, I hope you come this morning expecting an encounter with God. I hope you didn't come looking for an encounter with somebody else. Look at it with God, and then the other things, the benefits. God's what we ought to come for. And then he says, you know, thank my God, and he goes on and deals with it. The first thing this morning he's talking about is just live in love. Live in love, that we and I learn. That we talked about that genuine love last week. God's love for us, our love for sinners, our love for others. And then the love for spouse love. The thing is you and I got to learn to apply that. Making the application what it really is. Do you really love? I'm telling you, if you missed that last week, go back and look. Guys, go back and look at the video that we showed at the end. Several people called back and commented about that. Because I'm telling you, we need to learn to love each other. We need to learn to love our spouses. We need to learn to love like God really wants us to love. And to be what God wants us to be. And the thing is, you know, you may be getting tired of love. But you go back and look at 1 Corinthians and look what it says. Faith, hope, and love. The greatest of these is love. We need to hear about it. Because we need to be reminded. We're people that hate. We may not call it that. But we'll look at somebody and we'll be thinking in our mind. Just love Satan. And so we need to be embedded in this thing called love and what God really wants us to do. What God's telling us, and what Paul said, look, he ain't right yet. So we need to get a good dose of it over and over and over to really love like Jesus loves us, to teach us how to do that. Matter of fact, he said we can do everything else right. We can have kids, we can have bank accounts, we can do this, that, and other. We can serve at Our Daily Bread, we can go to the Seaman Center, we can be a deacon, we can get more money than we've ever given before, we can be at Sunday school for 50 years, never miss a day, but if we don't have love, this is always gone. It's empty. You see? And my prayer is that God would take us to levels that we've never seen, and God would show us how to love like we've never loved before. God would show us that deep love. You know what's wrong with America today? The lack of love. The lack of Christians. Displaying the love that God gave us. You know, the thing is, Paul is saying, I thank God for you. And look what he says. Because I hear about your love. I hear about your love. You know, what do you want people to know about you? Man, he was a guy who loved everybody. She was a lady who was there. She demonstrated love. She was there. They cared. Their home demonstrated the ability to care for those that they came in contact with. A love for the saints. A demonstration of love. Greater love had no man than this. And to lay down his life. Love those folks. Love in love. Live in love. Walk where God wants you to be. You know, think about it. Look at the people around you. When was the last time you looked at one of them and said, I love you, man? Not just the surface, I love you. But you really looked at them. Remember what I said to you last week? When was the last time you looked at your spouse and said, I love you and really mean it? Take it a step further. What about those in this building? Had that fellowship time a while ago when we had our highs and lows and all that kind of stuff. Did you tell somebody you love them? You love them and you mean it. People know. It's kind of like I said to you a few weeks ago, like somebody asked you how you're going to have a bad day. Don't say, okay, go on. Say, do you really have time for me to tell you? Maybe it's the best day of your life, or maybe it's the worst day of your life. And you say, hey, let's just sit down and talk about it. I'm having the worst time of my life. I'm in the valley. God's doing something big in my life. And I don't know what it is. Or, man, God's just touching my life. This is happening in my life. Really just share the story because of God's love. To share your story. Love those that you come in contact with. Minister to those you got contact with. Do what you got to do to touch lives. Pastor, I don't know. So what? God didn't call us to know. He called us to love. And he doesn't care what color they are, remember that. He doesn't care what color they are. And the thing is, here's the deal. When we realize a heart like his, when we realize God created a clean heart for me, when we realize loving others as Jesus loves us, when we realize that, it won't matter anymore. We'll be able to love them. Not only will we be able to love them, but we'll be able to demonstrate it completely. That we'll be able to live it out. And you know, a few years ago we did that weekend where we called Love Out Loud. That's exactly what will happen. Because we're in real life, real decisions, with real outcomes. And we'll be able to love out loud. And people will know it. People will know it. What greater testimony than somebody say, tell me about Temple. Man, it's a church that loves others. It's a group of people that will accept you and love you, help you on your journey. That's the testimony that you and I need to have. And the fact is, you know, they'll know, what does John 13:35 say? They'll know we're his disciples. They'll know we're Christians by our love. They'll know that. That's the most significant point right there. Refresh others. There, the latter part of verse 7. That you and I are refreshers. And we refresh others through the love so that we can serve others. so that we can do it when we get the phone call and we got something else to do and we have to drop it and go do something in the name of Jesus. Refresh her. Touch her lives. Paul didn't stop there. He said, live in love. But then look what he says. I thank my God as I remember you in my prayers because of what? I hear about your faith. It's one thing to say I have faith and to live it. Then the other side of that coin is to live it. So not only live in love, but act in faith. Live in faith. Ever how you want to put that? Live in that faith aspect of life. Paul says, I hear of your faith in the Lord. Man, what a testimony. Not only that you love, but your faith is in the Lord. That your faith is centered. And the thing is that when you talk about faith, listen guys, man, this is tough for us. It's not necessarily going to be black and white. It's not going to be just faith. It's going to be God's supernatural touches. It's outside of the black and white. I'm telling you, we have to get off the pages. Get out on the limb and say, God, here we are. And if you don't do something about it, God, we're going to fall. So we have to act in faith. What does Hebrews 11:1 say? Faith is what? The substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. The substance of things hoped for. Here's what NIV says. Being sure of what we hope for. And then certain of what we've not seen. Of what we've not been able to see. Faith, taking that step and letting God do what he needs to do. Our faith and the sharing of that faith will give, according to Paul, look what he says, that faith and that love, and then he says the sharing of the faith, there in verse 5, look what he says, will give you a full understanding of every good thing you have in Christ. And that's a huge statement right there. When we think about the fact of love, we're realizing that love aspect, that God loved us so much that he sent Jesus, his son, he came and died for us, that we are to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, that faith aspect, that you and I can't do it on our own selves. It's only by faith. We're saved through faith. That's not of ourselves, but it's a gift of God. In Christ Jesus. That's what he's talking about there. And once you're able to do that, then you'll have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. That means we've got to walk where he wants us to walk. Do what he's called us to do. Just be what he's asking us to be. That's all he's asking for us right there. And the understanding will come. And until one learns about his or her faith, they'll never receive the things of God. It's all based on the understanding. It's all based on the faith walk. Allowing God to speak into our life. Not living on human wisdom. It's not up to us. It's up to God. The only thing you and I do is what? Surrender. Surrender. God, I want to be obedient. Some of us, for the first time in our life, need to understand that word surrender. We've been trying to walk with God for a long time, but we've had all kinds of obstacles. Why? We've never surrendered. Faith aspect. Man, I'm telling you, it's tough when you can't see it in black and white. It's tough for me. But God calls us to walk in that faith aspect out of love that we believe that God's got our backs. That God's going to take care of us. What does he say? My God will supply all of our needs according to my wants. My God will supply all my needs according to what? His riches. Where? In Christ Jesus. I mean, he lays it out there for us. And you know, the thing is when you begin to just look and we try to walk, and this is a constant reminder because every one of us struggle with this, guys. This is not rocket science. It's just basic stuff. We struggle with that. But God says, remember what he did to the priest? Go down and put your feet in the water. And all you had to do was your toes touch the water. And what happened? The water parted. That's what he wants for you and I as individuals and our families and the church. To walk in faith. What if they just stayed on the dry land? Nothing would have happened. They had to have the faith to go and put their toes in the water to watch it. Real life. none of fantasy. And I'm telling you, it's passing. Real life is flying by. And we're making real decisions every day. It's going to affect our outcomes. And you and I need to understand that this morning. We need to live in love and act in faith. Here's the beauty of it. When you go back and look at Acts, and I hope you will, you'll find that these were uneducated, unlearned, ordinary, ignorant, if you will, people. But they were changing the world upside down. What did it say about the world? It says that people were around them were amazed and astonished at these ignorant, unlearned men. What was happening? Their faith and their love in Christ was put in action. That's what was happening. God's looking for that for you and I today. Do it in faith. Amazing signs. I'm telling you, how long? Now, if we just rise up, the community, the state, the nation will be amazed at the power of God. Those that are closest to you will be amazed at the power of God when you and I live in love and act in faith. That's what happened. You think about people in your life. When we talk about forsaking all, taking Jesus, you think about the people in your life that that's made a difference on. Live in love, act on faith, real life, real decisions, real outcomes. One last thing, look what Paul says. I want to back you up to Titus. I hope you still got your copy of God's Word open. I want you to see. Paul comes down there in Philemon, and he talks about the fact of doing what God has called you to do, refreshing the hearts of people. But the last thing that I want you to see, not only live in love and act in faith, but devote to do. Devote yourself to do. What does that mean, Pastor? It means get off your blessed assurance and get busy. That's what it means. And that's not my words, that's what Paul says, okay? And you know, if we were out in the woods, we may put it a different way. But basically, that's what he's talking about. And here's what he says. Look in Titus chapter 3 and verse 14. And look what he says. Our people must, that's not a might want to, might be an iffy. He says, our people must learn to devote themselves to do. To do what? To do what is good. To do what is godly. To do what God has called us to do. And I'm telling you this morning, church, that's where you and I are. We must learn to devote ourselves to do something in the name of Jesus Christ. When is the last time, and I want to just ask you, and I want you to respond out loud, when is the last time that you did something for the cause of Christ? Whatever it is, you define it. When is the last time? And then you begin to fill in the blanks right there. Because see, now I want you to look. Look what Paul says in verse 6 of Philemon. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith. Didn't say passive. Didn't say sitting by. He says, I want you to tell your story. Tell your story. Pastor, I don't have a story. Let me just tell you about saved. That's a bold statement. Because if you're saved this morning, you got a story. If it's nothing but this, I once was lost, and Jesus saved me. That's your story. That's your story. You can't get any simpler than that. If you don't have that story, then you don't have Jesus as Lord of your life. And you don't have a story to tell. And I'm telling you, that's what he's talking about when he says, our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good. And he goes on there and he talks about there in Titus, in order to provide for their daily necessities and not live, listen, unproductive lives. That goes back to living in love, acting in faith, devoting ourselves to do. And he comes down there again, and remember now, Titus was actually written after Philemon. He says, your love has given me the joy and the courage, encouragement. And that right there is just worth it. That's worth the price of admission today. I mean, the things that we're talking about today, that you and I are, is to have that full understanding of the Lord Jesus Christ. I gave you this list several weeks ago. You didn't get it, you can call the office, we'll give it to you. And I ask you over the next 6 months, would you be willing to do these 10 things? Have a regular time of devotion, Bible prayer, Bible reading, prayer with God. Pray for your pastor, staff, God's divine movement in the community. To lead someone to Christ before the year ends. To lead and encourage someone to get involved in the body of Christ. To lead out and share your testimony regularly as God's work in you and your life. I had two folks ask me about sharing the testimony here, and we had one testimony to share on Wednesday night. To get outside your comfort zone as God leads and lives and make a difference in His kingdom. To covenant with God and be obedient in church attendance, giving you time and talent for His glory. To reevaluate your life and lifestyle on a regular basis. To become involved in men, women, youth, children, Bible study. To make an effort in befriending someone you do not know very well. Those 10 things I asked you to do, didn't just laid it out there for you. And I'm telling you, as you do those things, if you're doing them, these are tools to get you to the understanding of what Paul's talking about. I didn't have all of this together at that point when God gave me that. I'm just going to be honest with you. But God began to bathe into my life over the last week since I gave you that and just began to expand that even more. Because here's the thing. God has the goal for you and I to be a refresher. Not a stinker-upper. Some of us just stink. You know, you're around that, you ever see that person when they come to you, you want to go the other way because you know they're going to complain? Are they going to, when you walk away from them, you're going to feel sick? That God wants us to be refreshers. He desires that we're uplifters. Now listen, that's not going to happen all the time. I understand that. You may need to be the uplifter. You may need to be the refresher. And when the person comes, you may need to listen, and then you turn around and pray with them. And through that encounter, they're uplifted. That's the deal with that. I mean, you know that person, when they come up, you look forward to seeing them because you know they're going to give you a hug. And that hug is just not just a, I mean, it's a hug. And you know that. Or that person's going to speak a word in your life. And you look forward to that word. You look forward to that text. But then you have on the other hand that person who just is sour. Doesn't matter if God goes and has dinner with them, they're going to be sour. Billy Graham invited them to North Carolina, they'd be sour. You know what I'm talking about. God wants us to be refreshing. Why? Because we live in real life, making real decisions and real outcomes. As a result of the encounter in this building today, there's going to be some outcomes. There's going to be some decisions. And when you go out of here, it's real life. It's just the way it is. And when you and I encounter somebody this week, same thing's going to apply. And I want to ask you, are you going to be a refresher? Are you going to be a downer? Are you going to be somebody that steals somebody's joy? Don't want to be that person. You don't want to be somebody that's going to take the joy away from another person. You want to live in love. You want to bring that joy. You want to bring that love. You want to bring that faith. You want to bring that movement of God. Because it is real life. We got people this morning contemplating suicide somewhere. Maybe somebody was doing it. I want you to know God loves you. And you're in a safe haven. People care about you in this building. They may not know you. But I can tell you what care about you. You got people that says, you know, that's it. I'm over. I'm done. I'm going to give up on my marriage. I'm giving up on life. I'm just going to try. You might know somebody like that. Somebody that's good with someone. You may feel that person. Could I just ask you to give God one chance? Can I ask you just to say, God, I'll do it one more time? Some people, you're going to encounter people at school. Maybe you. Where home life is tough. Maybe you find it hard to make relationships. That other person may find it hard to make relationships. I'm going to ask you just to reach out to one another and reach out to those folks who are home. Those folks that are on the sidelines and you're empty. Reach out. Reach out to them and touch them. Why? Because it's real life. It's real decisions. And it's real life. And as believers this morning, He's called us to live in love, to act on faith, and to devote ourselves to do it. And that means you and I can't sit still in the pew and be where God wants us to be. He wants wants us to be so much more. I'm telling you, we need to get busy from the oldest person to the youngest who's able to understand. We need to be busy. We live in a world that's upside down, but it's certainly not for Jesus Christ. You and I've got a message that we need to share. And it's love. It's the heart of our kids. It's a message of faith and devotion and living for Jesus Christ. I want to ask you to bow your head, Jim, if you've got to make your way back to the beginning of the blessing. As we move into this invitation time, I want to ask you this morning, if you pick that paper up, how you doing? Part of it's evaluation. If you're not where God wants you to be, would you take it and reevaluate? Nothing I ask you to do on that is outside the person of God. So I just challenge you in that area this morning. That may be one area just to be a doctor about, praying about. First and foremost, we need to be about salvation. Are you born again? Do you know that you know that you know that you're going to heaven? Just about eyes closed, nobody looking around. Do you know that you know that you know that you're going to heaven? First and foremost. Husband, are you being the husband God wants you to be? Are you taking your family where God wants it to go? You're responsible for that. Wives, this morning, are you being that respectful wife and honoring your husband, recognizing him? Are you walking where God wants you to walk? Child of God this morning, real life, real decisions, real outcomes, love and faith. Would you get off the blessed assurance and say, yes, Lord, put me to work. That's what it's about this morning. If somebody's struggling, suicide, break up with marriage, kids, financial issues, school issues, I don't know what kind of. We want to pray with you. Others, we want you to listen. These altars are coming to glorify God. Lay it on the altar. Man, what greater time for a family to come and say, Lord, we want to bless you. We want to thank you for putting us where you put us. We want to give you honor and glory for our salvation. That's what it's about this morning. Father, in the name of Jesus, it's your time, God. Holy Spirit of God, find us faithful. Have your way. In Christ's name, stand with us.